Hello and welcome back. In this video, we will have a look at biomarker candidate selection and the multiple testing problem, and also how you can export data from R. Imagine that you have calculated the p-value for each protein in the dataset and also the so-called fold change. The fold change is usually defined as the ratio of the means between the two groups. It is a measure of the effect size. That means how much the protein changes from one group to another, while the p-value is a measure of the statistical significance of this change. A protein is considered a good or promising biomarker candidate if the p-value is small and at the same time the fold change is far away from 1. So either large or low, which indicates a strong change between groups. In the volcano plot, the minus log 10 p-value is plotted against the log 2 fold change. So on the y-axis, small p-values are at the top because you transformed the p-value losing the log 10 and also the minus. So if you, for example, are here at 7, it means that the p-value is at 10 to the minus 7, so very small. On the x-axis, strong fold changes will be on the left and right side, and it is log 2 transformed to have a symmetry around 0, which corresponds to a ratio of means of 1, so no change between the two groups. You can also add limits, for example, a line corresponding to a level of 5%. Of course, this also has to be minus log 10 transformed. And limits for the fold change of 2.5, which translate to 1 and minus 1 on the log 2 level. In this volcano plot, each point corresponds to one protein, and the most promising candidates will be in the upper left and right corners. And you can also see why it is called volcano plot, because it looks a bit like an erupting volcano. The problem is that we calculate a lot of t-tests on the same data set, and we have a so-called inflation of the type 1 error rate. So, as a reminder, type 1 error is when the null hypothesis H0 is true, but you decide to reject during the t-test. This type 1 error rate inflation is because the type 1 error is only controlled for a single test. And here is a little example. So imagine that we have 1010 proteins in a data set, and we knew that 10 of them are truly differentially expressed. And for the other 1000, there is no difference between groups. So here H0 is true, and for this 10, H1 is true. So and now we will conduct 1010 t-tests for each protein. And if we have enough samples, we will have a good power, and we will recognize these 10 differentially expressed proteins as significant results during the t-test. So here we will not make any type 2 error. But for the 1000 proteins where H0 is true, we will make a type 1 error with a probability of 5% each time. So when we do 1000 tests, we would expect around 50 false positives findings, which have a significant results in the t-test, but they are wrong. So in total, we have 60 significant results, but only 10 of them are true. In this case, we will have a false positive rate of about 83%, which is very, very high. So we cannot trust the results because we know we have 60 results, but only a small proportion of them are true. There are some methods that adjust the p-values by making them larger and therefore less significant. However, those candidate proteins that have still a p-value below 5% after this correction are more reliable because the FDR, so the false discovery rate, is limited to 5% by these methods. In R, for example, you can use the p.adjust function. The p here is a vector of your p-values, and you can use method as FDR, which will apply the Benjamini-Hochberg procedure for p-value correction. In a volcano plot, you usually use the uncorrected p-values on the y-axis, but you can color those proteins that are significant after the p-value correction. So these are the orange ones. These are the ones that stay significant even after this p-value correction. If you now have a list of promising biomarker candidates, it is advisable to have a look at them, for example, by looking at such abundance profiles. Here you can see how big the difference between the two groups is and if there are maybe any outliers in one of the groups. If you have results like tables with your p-values and fold changes, you may want to export this data. And the save command can store one or more R objects into a so-called R data object, which has the file ending .rdata, and you can reload it into R using the load function. This is useful if you did long calculations to receive this object and you want to use it later again without the need to do all the calculations again. However, it is not possible to use this RData object outside of R. The save image function is similar to the save function, but it will store all objects that you have in your current environment. If you want to use data outside of R, the write table function is useful, which can be used to write a data frame or a matrix into a TXT file. So it is more or less the opposite of the read table function. With X, you can specify the object that you want to save, and file is the path where you want to save it. These other options are basically the same as for read table, so I will skip them here at this point. In the next video, we will learn how to create graphics in R.